हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, आज हम क्लास 11 बायोलॉजी एनसीईआरटी की बुक से चैप्टर 13 फोटोसिंथेसिस इन हायर प्लांट्स का रीडिंग करेंगे। अगर आपको बुक्स खरीदनी है तो लिंक मैंने डिस्क्रिप्शन में दे दिए हैं। ऑल एनिमल्स इंक्लूडिंग ह्यूमन बींग डिपेंड ऑन प्लांट्स फॉर देयर फूड। हैव यू एवर वंडर्ड फ्रॉम वेयर प्लांट्स गेट देयर फूड? ग्रीन प्लांट्स इन फैक्ट हैव टू मेक और रादर सिंथेसाइज द फूड दे नीड, एंड ऑल अदर ऑर्गेनिजम्स डिपेंड ऑन देम फॉर देयर नीड्स। The green plants make or rather synthesize the food they need through photosynthesis and are therefore called autotrophs. You have already learned that the autotrophic nutrition is found only in plants, and all other organisms that depend on the green plants are for food are heterotrophs. Green plants carry out photosynthesis, a physicochemical process by which they use light energy to drive the synthesis of organic compounds. Ultimately, all living forms on earth depend on sunlight for energy. The use of energy from sunlight by plants doing photosynthesis is the basis of life on earth. Photosynthesis is important due to two reasons. It is the primary source of all food on earth. It is also responsible for the release of oxygen into the atmosphere by green plants. Have you ever thought what would happen if there were no oxygen to breathe? This chapter focuses on the structure of the photosynthetic machinery and the various reactions that transform light energy into chemical energy. 13.1. What do we know? Let us try to find out what we already know about photosynthesis. Some simple experiments you may have done in the earlier classes have shown that chlorophyll, that is green pigment of the leaf, light and CO2 are required for photosynthesis to occur. You may have carried out the experiment to look for starch formation into leaves, a variegated leaf or a leaf that was partially covered with black paper and exposed to light. On tasting this leaves for the presence of starch, it was clear that photosynthesis occurred only in the green parts of the leaves in the presence of light. Another experiment you may have carried out where a part of leaf is enclosed in a test tube containing some KOH-soaked cotton which absorbs CO2 while the other half is exposed to air. The setup is then placed in light for some time. On tasting for the presence of starch later in the two parts of the leaf, you must have found that the exposed part of the leaf tasted positive for starch while the portion that was in the tube tasted negative. This showed that carbon dioxide was required for photosynthesis. Can you explain how this conclusion could be drawn? 13.2 Early experiments. It is interestingly to learn about those simple experiments that led to a gradual development in our understanding of photosynthesis. Joseph Priestley in 1733 to 1804 in 1770 performed a series of experiments that revealed the essential role of air in the growth of green plants. Priestley, you may recall, discovered oxygen in 1774. Priestley observed that a candle burning in a closed space, a bell jar, soon gets extinguished. Similarly, a mouse would soon suffocate in a closed space. He concluded that a burning candle or an animal that breathed the air both somehow damaged the air. But when he placed a mint plant in the same bell jar, he found that the mouse stayed alive and the candle continued to burn. Priestley hypothesized as follows: plants restore the air whatever breathing animals and burning candles remove. Can you imagine how Priestley would have conducted the experiment using a candle and a plant? Remember, he would need to rekindle the candle to taste whether it burns after a few days. How many different ways can you think of the light, the candle, without disturbing the setup? Using a similar setup as the one used by Priestley, but by replacing it once in the dark and once in the sunlight, Jane Ingenhouse in 1730 to 1799 showed that sunlight is essential to the plant process that somehow purifies the air formed by burning candles or breathing animals. Ingenhouse, in an elegant experiment with an aquatic plant, showed that in bright sunlight, small bubbles were formed around the green parts while in the dark they did not. Later he identified these bubbles to be of oxygen. Hence, he showed that it is only the green part of the plant that could release oxygen. It was not until about 1854 that Julius von Seix provided evidence for production of glucose when plants grow. Glucose is usually stored as starch. His later studies show that the green substance in plants, that is chlorophyll as we know it now, is located in spatial bodies, later called chloroplasts, within plant cells. He found that the green parts in plants is where glucose is made and that the glucose is usually stored as starch. Now consider the interesting experiments done by T.W. Engelmann in bracket 1843 to 1909. Using a prism, he split light into a spectral components and then illuminated a green alga, Cladophora, placed in a suspension of aerobic bacteria. The bacteria were used to detect the sites of O2 evolution. He observed that the bacteria accumulated mainly in the region of blue and red light of the split spectrum. A first action spectrum of photosynthesis was thus described. It resembles roughly the absorption spectra of chlorophyll A and B, in bracket discussed in section 13.4. By the middle of the 19th century, the key features of plant photosynthesis were known, namely that plants could use light energy to make carbohydrate from carbon dioxide and water. The empirical equation representing the total process of photosynthesis for oxygen-evolving organisms was then understood as CO2 plus H2O in presence of light will form CH2O plus O2, where CH2O represented a carbohydrate, for example glucose, a 6-carbon sugar. A milestone contribution to the understanding of photosynthesis was that made by a microbiologist, Cornelius van Niel, in bracket 1897 to 1985, who based on his studies of purple and green bacteria demonstrated that photosynthesis is essentially a light-dependent reaction in which hydrogen from a suitable oxidizable compound reduces carbon dioxide to carbohydrates. This can be expressed by 2H2A plus CO2 in presence of light will form 2A plus CH2O plus H2O. In green plants, H2O is the hydrogen donor and is oxidized to O2. Some organisms do not release O2 during photosynthesis. When H2S instead is the hydrogen donor for purple and green sulfur bacteria, the oxidation product is sulfur or sulfate depending on the organism and not O2. Hence, he inferred that the O2 evolved by the green plant comes from H2O, not from carbon dioxide. This was later proved by using radioisotopic techniques. The correct equation that would represent the overall process of photosynthesis is therefore 6CO2 plus 12H2O in presence of light will form C6H12O6 plus 6H2O plus 6O2, where C6H12O6 represents glucose. The O2 released is from water. This was proved using radioisotope techniques. Note that this is not a single reaction but description of a multi-step process called photosynthesis. Can you explain why 12 molecules of water as substrate are used in the equation given above? 13.3. Where does photosynthesis take place? You would of course answer in the green leaf or in the chloroplast based on what you earlier read in chapter 8. You are definitely right. Photosynthesis does take place in the green leaves of plants, but it does so also in other green parts of the plants. Can you name some other parts where you think photosynthesis may occur? You would recollect from previous unit that the mesophyll cells in the leaves have a large number of chloroplasts. Usually, the chloroplasts align themselves along the walls of the mesophyll cells such that they get the optimum quantity of the incident light. When do you think the chloroplasts will be aligned with their flat surfaces parallel to the walls? When would they be perpendicular to the incident light? You have studied the structure of chloroplast in chapter 8. Within the chloroplast, there is a membranous system consisting of grana, the stroma lamella, and the matrix stroma. There is a clear division of labor within the chloroplast. The membrane system is responsible for trapping the light energy and also for the synthesizing of ATP and NADPH. In stroma, enzymatic reactions synthesize sugar, which in turn forms starch. The former setup of reactions, since they are directly light-driven, are called light reactions, in bracket photochemical reactions. The latter are not directly light-driven but are dependent on the products of light reactions, that is ATP and NADPH. Hence, to distinguish the latter, they are called by convention as dark reactions, in bracket carbon reactions. However, they should not be again I am reading this line, however, this should not be construed to mean that they occur in darkness or that they are not light dependent. 13.4, how many types of pigments are involved in photosynthesis? Looking at plants, have you wondered why and how there are so many shades of green in the leaves, even in the same plants? We can look for an answer to this question by trying to separate the leaf pigments of any green plant through paper chromatography. A chromatographic separation of the leaf pigment shows that the color that we see in leaves is not due to a single pigment, but due to the four pigments. Chlorophyll A, in bracket bright or blue-green, in the chromatogram, chlorophyll B, yellow-green, xanthophylls, that is yellow, and carotenoids, that is yellow to yellow-orange. Let us now see what roles various pigments play in photosynthesis. Pigments are substances that have an ability to absorb light at specific wavelengths. Can you guess which is the most abundant plant pigment in the world? Let us study the graph showing the ability of chlorophyll A pigment to absorb light of different wavelengths. Of course, you are familiar with the wavelength of the visible spectrum of light as well as wavelength. From figure 13.3a, can you determine the wavelength at which chlorophyll A shows the maximum absorption? Does it show another absorption peak at any other wavelengths too? If yes, which one? Now look at figure 13.3b showing the wavelengths at which maximum photosynthesis occurs in plants. Can you see that the wavelengths at which there is a maximum absorption by chlorophyll A, that is in the blue and the red regions, also shows higher rate of photosynthesis? Hence, we can conclude that chlorophyll A is the chief pigment associated with photosynthesis. But by looking at figure 13.3c, can you say that there is a complete one-to-one overlap between the absorption spectrum of chlorophyll A and the action spectrum of photosynthesis? These graphs together show that most of the photosynthesis takes place in the blue and red regions of the spectrum. Some photosynthesis does take place at the other wavelengths of the visible spectrum. Let us see how this happens. Though chlorophyll is the major pigment responsible for trapping light, other thylakoid pigments like chlorophyll B, xanthophylls and carotenoids, which are called accessory pigments, also absorb light and transfer the energy to chlorophyll A. Indeed, they not only enable a wider range of wavelength of incoming light to be utilized for photosynthesis, but also protect chlorophyll A from photooxidation. 13.5. What is light reaction? Light reactions or the photochemical phase include light absorption, water splitting, oxygen release, and the formation of high energy chemical intermediates ATP and NADPH. Several protein complexes are involved in the process. The pigments are organized into two discrete photochemical light harvesting complexes, in bracket LHC, within the photosystem 1, in bracket PS1, and photosystem 2, also known as PS2. These are named in the sequence of the discovery and not in the sequence in which they function during the light reaction. The LHC are made up of hundreds of pigment molecules bound to proteins. Each photosystem is all the pigments, in bracket except one molecule of chlorophyll A, forming a light harvesting system, also called antennae. These pigments help to make photosynthesis more efficient by absorbing different wavelengths of light. The single chlorophyll A molecule forms the reaction center. The reaction center is different in both the photosystems. In PS1, the reaction center chlorophyll A has an absorption peak at 700 nanometer, hence is called P700, while in PS2, it has absorption maxima at 680 nanometer and is called P680. 13.6, the electron transport. In photosystem 2, the reaction center chlorophyll A absorbs 680 nanometer wavelength of red light, causing electrons to become excited and jump into an orbit farther from the atomic nucleus. These electrons are picked up by an electron acceptor, which passes them to an electron transport system consisting of cytochromes. This movement of electrons is downhill in terms of an oxidation reduction or redox potential scale. The electrons are not used up as they pass through the electron transport chain, but are passed onto the pigments of photosystem, that is PS1. Simultaneously, electrons in the reaction center of PS1 are also excited when they receive red light of wavelength 700 nanometer and are transferred to another acceptor molecule that has a greater redox potential. These electrons then are moved downhill again, this time to a molecule of energy rich NADP+. The addition of these electrons reduces NADP+ to NADPH plus H+. This whole scheme of transfer of electrons, starting from the PS2, uphill to the acceptor, down the electron transport chain to PS1, excitation of electrons, transfer to another acceptor, and finally downhill to NADP+, reducing it to NADPH plus H+, is called the Z scheme due to its characteristic shape. This shape is formed when all the carriers are placed in a sequence on a redox potential scale. 13.6.1 splitting of water. You would then ask, how does PS2 supply electrons continuously? The electrons that were moved from photosystem 2 must be replaced. This achieved by electrons available due to splitting of water. The splitting of water is associated with the PS2. Water is split into 2H+, oxygen and electrons. This creates oxygen, one of the net products of photosynthesis. The electrons needed to replace those removed from photosystem 1 are provided by photosystem 2. 2H2O will form 4H plus plus O2 plus 4 electrons. We need to emphasize here that the water splitting complex is associated with the PS2, which itself is physically located on the inner side of the membrane of the thylakoid. Then where are the protons and O2 formed likely to be released? In the lumen or on the outer side of the membrane? 13.6.2 Cyclic and non-cyclic photophosphorylation. Living organisms have the capability of extracting energy from oxidizable substances and store this in the form of bond energy. Special substances like ATP carry this energy in their chemical bonds. The process through which ATP is synthesized by cells, in mitochondria and chloroplasts, is named phosphorylation. Photophosphorylation is the synthesis of ATP from ADP and inorganic phosphate in the presence of a light. When the two photosystems work in a series, first PS2 and then the PS1, a process called non-cyclic photophosphorylation occurs. The two photosystems are connected through an electron transport chain as seen earlier in the Z scheme. Both ATP and NADPH plus H+ are synthesized by this kind of electron flow. When only PS1 is functional, the electron is circulated within the photosystem and the phosphorylation occurs due to cyclic flow of electrons. A possible location where this could be happening is in the stroma, lamella. While the membrane or lamella of the grana have both PS1 and PS2, the stroma lamella membranes lack PS2 as well as NADP reductase enzyme. The excited electron does not pass on to NADP+, but is cycled back to the PS1 complex through the electron transport chain. The cyclic flow hence results only in the synthesis of ATP, but not to NADPH plus H+. Cyclic photophosphorylation also occurs when only light of wavelengths beyond 680 nanometer are available for excitation. 13.6.3 Chemiosmotic hypothesis. Let us now try to understand how actually ATP is synthesized in the chloroplast. The chemiosmotic hypothesis has been put forward to explain the mechanism. Like in respiration, in photosynthesis too, ATP synthesis is linked to development of a proton gradient across membrane. This time, these are the membranes of thylakoid. There is one difference though. Here, the proton accumulation is toward the inside of the membrane, that is in the lumen. In respiration, protons accumulate in the intermembrane space of the mitochondria when electrons move through the ETS. Let us understand what causes the proton gradient across the membrane. We need to consider again the processes that take place during the activation of electrons and the transport to determine the steps that cause a proton gradient to develop. A. Since splitting of the water molecule takes place on the inner side of the membrane, the protons or hydrogen ions that are produced by the splitting of water accumulate within the lumen of the thylakoids. B. As electrons move through the photosystems, protons are transported across the membrane. This happens because the primary acceptor of electron, which is located towards the outer side of the membrane, transports its electron not to an electron carrier but to an H carrier. Hence, this molecule removes a proton from the stroma while transporting an electron. When this molecule passes on its electron to the electron carrier on the inner side of the membrane, the proton is released into the inner side or the Lehmann side of the membrane. C. The NADP reductase enzyme is located on the stroma side of the membrane. Along with electrons that come from the acceptor of electrons of PS1, protons are necessary for the reduction of NADP plus to NADPH plus H plus. These protons are also removed from the stroma. Hence, within the chloroplast, protons in the stroma decrease in number, while in the lumen there is accumulation of protons. This creates a proton gradient across the thylakoid membrane as well as measurable decrease in pH in the lumen. Why are we so interested in the proton gradient? This gradient is important because it is the breakdown of this gradient that leads to the synthesis of ATP. The gradient is broken down due to the movement of proton across the membrane to the stroma through the transmembrane channel of the CF0 of the ATP synthase. The ATP synthase enzyme consists of two parts. One called the CF0 is embedded in the thylakoid membrane and forms a transmembrane channel that carries out facilitated diffusion of proton across the membrane. The other portion is called CF1 and protrudes on the outer surface of the thylakoid membrane on the side of that faces the stroma. The breakdown of the gradient provides enough energy to cause a conformational change in the CF1 particle of the ATP synthase, which makes the enzyme synthesize several molecules of energy-packed ATP. Chemiosmosis requires a membrane, a proton pump, a proton gradient, and ATP synthase. Energy is used to pump protons across a membrane to create a gradient or a high concentration of protons within the thylakoid lumen. ATP synthase is a channel that allows diffusion of protons back across the membrane. This releases enough energy to activate ATP synthase enzyme that catalyzes the formation of ATP. Along with the NADPH produced by the movement of electrons, the ATP will be used immediately in the biosynthetic reaction taking place in the stroma, responsible for fixing CO2 and synthesis of sugars. 13.7. Where are the ATP and NADPH used? We learned that the products of light reaction are ATP, NADPH, and O2. Of this, O2 diffuses out of the chloroplast while ATP and NADPH are used to drive the processes, leading to the synthesis of food, more accurately sugars. This is the biosynthetic phase of photosynthesis. This process does not directly depend on the presence of light, but is dependent on the products of the light reaction, that is ATP and NADPH, besides CO2 and H2O. You may wonder how this would be verified. It is simple. Immediately after light becomes unavailable, the biosynthetic process continues for some time and then stops. If then light is made available, the synthesis starts again. Can we hence say that calling the biosynthetic phase as the dark reaction is a misnomer? Discuss this amongst yourselves. Let us now see how the ATP and NADPH are used in the biosynthetic phase. We show earlier that CO2 is combined with H2O to produce CH2O, bracket over N, or sugars. It was of interest to scientists to find out how this reaction proceeds, or rather, what was the first product formed when CO2 is taken into a reaction or fixed. Just after World War II, among the several efforts to put radioisotopes to beneficial use, the work of Melvin Kelvin is exemplary. The use of radioactive carbon-14 by him in alkyl photosynthesis studies led to the discovery that the first CO2 fixation product was a 3-carbon organic acid. He also contributed to working out the complete biosynthetic pathway. Hence, it was called Kelvin cycle after him. The first product identified was 3-phosphoglyceric acid, or in short PGA. How many carbon atoms does it have? Scientists also tried to know whether all plants have PGA as the first product of CO2 fixation or whether any other product was formed in other plants. Experiments conducted over a wide range of plants led to the discovery of another group of plants where the first stable product of CO2 fixation was again an organic acid, but one which had 4 carbon atoms in it. This acid was identified to be oxoacetic acid, or OAA. Since then, CO2 assimilation during photosynthesis was said to be of two main types, those plants in which the first product of CO2 fixation is a C3 acid, in bracket PGA, that is the C3 pathway, and those in which the first product was a C4 acid, in bracket OAA, that is the C4 pathway. These two groups of plants showed other associated characteristics that we will discuss later. 13.7.1, the primary acceptor of CO2. Let us now ask ourselves a question that was asked by the scientists who were struggling to understand the dark reaction. How many carbon atoms would a molecule have which after accepting CO2 would have 3 carbons? The studies very unexpectedly showed that the acceptor molecule was a 5-carbon keto sugar, ribulose biphosphate in bracket RUBP. Did any of you think of this possibility? Don't worry. The scientists also took a long time and conducted many experiments to reach this conclusion. They also believed that since the first product was a C3 acid, the primary acceptor would be a 2-carbon compound. They spent many years trying to identify a 2-carbon compound before they discovered the 5-carbon RUBP. 13.7.2, the Kelvin cycle. Kelvin and his co-workers then worked out the whole pathway and showed that the pathway operated in a cyclic manner. The RUBP was regenerated. Let us now see how the Kelvin pathway operates and where the sugar is synthesized. Let us at the outset understand very clearly that the Kelvin pathway occurs in all photosynthetic plants. It does not matter whether they have C3 or C4 pathways. For ease of understanding, the Kelvin cycle can be described under 3 stages: carboxylation, reduction, and regeneration. So first is carboxylation. Carboxylation is the fixation of CO2 into a stable organic intermediate. Carboxylation is the most crucial step of the Kelvin cycle, where CO2 is utilized for the carboxylation of RUBP. This reaction is catalyzed by the enzyme RUBP carboxylase, which results in the formation of 2 molecules of 3-PGA. Since this enzyme also has an oxygenation activity, it would be more correct to call it RUBP carboxylase oxygenase or Rubisco. Second, reduction. These are a series of reactions that lead to the formation of glucose. The steps involve utilization of 2 molecules of ATP for phosphorylation and 2 of NADPH for reduction per CO2 molecule fixed. The fixation of 6 molecules of CO2 and 6 tons of the cycle are required for the formation of 1 molecule of glucose from the pathway. Third, regeneration. Regeneration of the carbon dioxide acceptor molecule RUBP is crucial if the cycle is to continue uninterrupted. The regeneration steps require 1 ATP for phosphorylation to form RUBP. Hence, for every CO2 molecule entering the Kelvin cycle, 3 molecules of ATP and 2 of NADPH are required. It is probably to meet this difference in number of ATP and NADPH used in the dark reaction that the cyclic phosphorylation takes place. To make 1 molecule of glucose, 6 tons of the cycle are required. Work out how many ATP and NADPH molecules will be required to make 1 molecule of glucose through the Kelvin pathway. It might help you to understand all of this if we look at what goes in and what comes out of the Kelvin cycle. 13.8, the C4 pathway. Plants that are adapted to dry tropical regions have the C4 pathway mentioned earlier. Though these plants have the C4 oxaloacetic acid as the first CO2 fixation product, they use the C3 pathway or the Kelvin cycle as the main biosynthetic pathway. Then in what way are they different from C3 plants? This is a question that you may reasonably ask. C4 plants are special. They have a special type of leaf anatomy. They tolerate higher temperatures. They show a response to high light intensities. They lack a process called photorespiration and have a greater productivity of biomass. Let us understand this one by one. Study vertical section of leaves, one of a C3 plant and the other of a C4 plant. Do you notice the differences? Do both have the same types of mesophylls? Do they have similar cells around the vascular bundle sheath? The particularly large cells around the vascular bundles of the C4 plants are called bundle sheath cells, and the leaves which have such anatomy are said to have Krenz anatomy. Krenz means breadth, and is a reflection of the arrangement of cells. The bundle sheath cells may form several layers around the vascular bundles. They are characterized by having a large number of chloroplasts, thick walls impervious to gaseous exchange, and no intracellular spaces. You may like to cut a section of the leaves of C4 plants, maize or sorghum, to observe the Krenz anatomy and the distribution of mesophyll cells. It would be interesting for you to collect leaves of diverse species of plants around you and cut vertical sections of the leaves. Observe under the microscope, look for the bundle sheath around the vascular bundles. The presence of the bundle sheath would help you identify the C4 plants. Now study the pathway shown in figure 13.9. This pathway that has been named the hedge and slack pathway is again a cyclic process. Let us study the pathway by listing the steps. The primary CO2 acceptor is a 3-carbon molecule, phosphoenol pyruvate, in bracket PEP, and is present in the mesophyll cells. The enzyme responsible for this fixation is PEP carboxylase or PEPcase. It is important to register that the mesophyll cells lack Rubisco enzyme. The C4 acid OAA is formed in the mesophyll cells. It then forms other 4-carbon compounds like malic acid or aspartic acid in the mesophyll cells itself, which are transported to the bundle sheath cells. In the bundle sheath cells, these C4 acids are broken down to release CO2 and a 3-carbon molecule. The 3-carbon molecule is transported back to the mesophyll, where it is converted to PEP again, thus completing the cycle. The CO2 released in the bundle sheath cells enters the C3 or the Kelvin pathway, a pathway common to all plants. The bundle sheath cells are rich in an enzyme, ribulose biphosphate carboxylase oxygenase, that is Rubisco, but lack PEPcase. Thus, the basic pathway that results in the formation of the sugars, the Kelvin pathway, is common to the C3 and C4 plants. Did you note that the Kelvin pathway occurs in all the mesophyll cells of the C3 plants? In the C4 plants, it does not take place in the mesophyll cells, but does so only in the bundle sheath cells. 13.9. Photorespiration. Let us try and understand one more process that creates an important difference between C3 and C4 plants, photorespiration. To understand photorespiration, we have to know a little bit more about the first step of the Kelvin pathway, the first CO2 fixation step. This is the reaction where RuBP combines with CO2 to form a 2-molecule of 3-PGA that is catalyzed by Rubisco. RuBP plus CO2 in the presence of Rubisco will form 2×3-PGA. Rubisco, that is the most abundant enzyme in the world. Do you wonder why? It's characterized by the fact that its active site can bind to both CO2 and O2, hence the name. Can you think how this could be possible? Rubisco has a much greater affinity for CO2 when the CO2, O2 is nearly equal. Imagine what would happen if this were not so. This binding is competitive. It is the relative concentration of O2 and CO2 that determines which of the two will bind to the enzyme. In C3 plants, some O2 does bind to Rubisco and hence CO2 fixation is decreased. Here the RuBP, instead of being converted to or 2 molecules of PGA, binds with O2 to form 1 molecule of phosphoglycerate and phosphoglycolate, in bracket 2-carbon, in a pathway called photorespiration. In the photorespiratory pathway, there is neither synthesis of sugars nor of ATP. Rather, it results in the release of CO2 with the utilization of ATP. In the photorespiratory pathway, there is no synthesis of ATP or NADPH. The biological function of photorespiration is not known yet. In C4 plants, photorespiration does not occur. This is because they have a mechanism that increases the concentration of CO2 at the enzyme site. This takes place when the C4 acid from the mesophyll is broken down in the bundle sheath cells to release CO2. This results in increasing the intracellular concentration of CO2. In turn, this ensures that the Rubisco functions as a carboxylase, minimizing the oxygenase activity. Now that you know that the C4 plants lack photorespiration, you probably can understand why productivity and yields are better in these plants. In addition, these plants show tolerance to higher temperatures. Based on the above discussion, can you compare plants showing the C3 and the C4 pathway? Use the table format given and fill in the formation. Factors affecting photosynthesis. An understanding of the factors that affect photosynthesis is necessary. The rate of photosynthesis is very important in determining the yield of plants, including crop plants. Photosynthesis is under the influence of several factors, both internal plant and external. The plant factors include the number, size, age, and orientation of leaves, mesophyll cells, and chloroplast, internal CO2 concentration, and the amount of chlorophyll. The plant or internal factors are dependent on the genetic predisposition and the growth of the plant. The external factors would include the availability of sunlight, temperature, CO2 concentration, and water. As a plant photosynthesizes, all these factors will simultaneously affect its rate. Hence, though several factors interact and simultaneously affect photosynthesis or CO2 fixation, usually one factor is the major cause or is the one that limits the rate. Hence, at any point, the rate will be determined by the factor available at suboptimal levels. When several factors affect the biochemical processes, Black means in 1905, law of limiting factors come into effect. This states that the following. If a chemical process is affected by more than one factor, then its rate will be determined by the factor which is nearest to its minimal value. It is the factor which directly affects the process if its quantity is changed. For example, despite the presence of a green leaf and optimal light and CO2 conditions, the plant may not photosynthesize if the temperature is very low. This leaf is given the optimal temperature, will start photosynthesizing. 13.10.1 Light. We need to distinguish between light quality, light intensity, and the duration of exposure to light while discussing light as a factor that affects photosynthesis. There is a linear relationship between incident light and CO2 fixation rates at low light intensities. At higher light intensities, gradually the rate does not show further increase as other factors become limiting. What is interesting to note is that light saturation occurs at 10% of the full sunlight. Hence, except for plants in shade or in dense forest, light is rarely a limiting factor in nature. Increase in incident light beyond a point causes the breakdown of chlorophyll and a decrease in photosynthesis. 13.10.2 Carbon dioxide concentration. Carbon dioxide is the major limiting factor for photosynthesis. The concentration of CO2 is very low in the atmosphere, that is between 0.03 and 0.04%. Increase in concentration up to 0.05% can cause an increase in CO2 fixation rates. Beyond this, the levels can become damaging over longer periods. The C3 and C4 plants respond differently to CO2 concentrations. At low light conditions, neither group responds to high CO2 conditions. At high light intensities, both C3 and C4 plants show increase in the rates of photosynthesis. What is important to note is that the C4 plants show saturation at about 360 micro 1 per liter, while C3 responds to increased CO2 concentration and saturation is seen only beyond 450 micro per liter. Thus, current availability of CO2 levels is limiting to the C3 plants. The fact that C3 plants respond to higher CO2 concentration by showing increased rate of photosynthesis leading to higher productivity has been used for some greenhouse crops such as tomatoes and bell pepper. They are allowed to grow in carbon dioxide enriched atmosphere that leads to the higher yields. 13.10.3 Temperature. The dark reactions being enzymatic are temperature controlled. Though the light reactions are also temperature sensitive, they are affected to a much lesser extent. The C4 plants respond to higher temperatures and show higher rate of photosynthesis, while C3 plants have a much lower temperature optimum. The temperature optimum for photosynthesis of different plants also depends on the habitat that they are adapted to. Tropical plants have a higher temperature optimum than the plants adapted to temperature climates. 13.10.4 Water. Even though water is one of the reactants in the light reaction, the effect of water as a factor is more through its effect on the plant rather than directly on photosynthesis. Water stress causes the stomata to close, hence reducing the CO2 availability. Besides, water stress also makes leaves wilt, thus reducing the surface area of the leaves and their metabolic activity as well. Summary: green plants make their own food by photosynthesis. During this process, carbon dioxide from the atmosphere is taken in by leaves through stomata and used for making carbohydrates, principally glucose and starch. Photosynthesis takes place only in the green parts of the plants, mainly the leaves. Within the leaves, the mesophyll cells have a large number of chloroplasts that are responsible for CO2 fixation. Within the chloroplasts, the membranes are sites for the light reaction, while the chemosynthetic pathway occurs in the stroma. Photosynthesis has two stages, the light reaction and the carbon fixing reaction. In the light reaction, the light energy is absorbed by the pigments present in the antenna and funneled to special chlorophyll A molecules called reaction center chlorophylls. There are two photosystems, PS1 and PS2. PS1 has a 700 nanometer absorbing chlorophyll A P700 molecule at its reaction center, while PS2 has a P680 reaction center that absorbs red light at 680 nanometer. After absorbing light, electrons are excited and transferred through PS2 and PS1 and finally to NAD, forming NADH. During this process, a proton gradient is created across the membrane of the thylakoid. The breakdown of the proton's gradient due to movement through the F0 part of the ATPase enzyme releases enough energy for synthesis of ATP. Splitting of water molecule is associated with PS2, resulting in the release of O2, protons and transfer of electrons to PS2. In the carbon fixation cycle, CO2 is added by the enzyme Rubisco to a 5-carbon compound RuBP that is converted to 2 molecules of 3-carbon PGA. This is then converted to sugar by the Kelvin cycle and the RuBP is regenerated. During this process, ATP and NADPH synthesized in the light reaction are utilized. Rubisco also catalyzes a wasteful oxygenation reaction in C3 plants, photorespiration. Some tropical plants show a special type of photosynthesis called C4 pathway. In these plants, the first product of CO2 fixation that takes place in the mesophyll is a 4-carbon compound. In the bundle sheath cell, the Kelvin pathway is carried out for the synthesis of carbohydrates.